Hello, everyone, and welcome along to another spectacular edition, I hope anyway, of Fake News Friday. Andrew Lawton in for Candace Malcolm, your rightful host, who I promise will return to this chair at some moment, just not in this show anyway, unless she does like the Kool-Aid man and just barges in going, oh yeah, at some point midway through, which, you know what, would make for good television. But to keep some semblance of continuity, we do have our trusty co-host Harrison Faulkner with us, as always, host of the True North Show, Ratioed. Harrison, good to have you here. Thanks very much.
Good to see you, Andrew. Good to see that you're filling in for Candace while she's away, and hopefully the show keeps on rolling.
Yeah, that's a big expectation for me in the summer. And I like that I said it was good to have you here, as though I'm not the one that's just like barged in unannounced to guest co-host over the course of the next little while. And I will say, I mean, just in the spirit of fake news, the fakest news of all is that this is Canada Day, because as many of you know, if you've been longtime subscribers to True North and you've heard my annual rant about this, it's actually Dominion Day. It's not Canada Day. It shouldn't be Canada Day. So I proudly say to you all, if you say Happy Canada Day, it's fake news. Blessed Dominion Day to all of you, and you too, Harrison. See, you're too young for Dominion Day, but hopefully we can bring it back and make it cool again, if it was ever cool. I think it was cool. We got lots of stuff happening, though. I mean, right now on Parliament Hill, we know that a lot of festivities are going on, and surely we'll have lots of fake news to break down about that next week, because we know that the media has just been relentless since the convoy originally in January of this year at mischaracterizing all of these people that are supporting freedom movements, supporting the convoy. We saw it with the arrest of Tamara Leach this week. We saw it with the convoy. We've seen it in the lead up to the Canada Day, Dominion Day, festivities this week. And even now, just looking at the way Conservative leader Candace Bergen has been treated for this little exchange she had on Evan Solomon's show on CTV.
Just in the last week, over 20 members of your party met with one person, James Stopp, who was not part of the trucker convoy. I've spoken to him. He's a veteran. He's marched across Canada about mandates. But they also met with a guy named Tom Marazzo, who was a spokesperson, also a veteran, by the way, who I've spoken to. This is a guy that stood in a press conference during the convoy and said he'd like to work in a coalition with your party, the Bloc, the NDP, to try to form a government. What does it tell Canadians that someone like you were with the truckers who took pictures, many of your members, and now here we are, 20 members, almost 20% of your caucus is out there essentially saying, as one member said, we're allies, you have their support. What does that tell you?
We very much support Canadians who are, were and still are against the mandatory vaccines. We don't believe that they should be wedged, called names, stigmatized. We don't think they should be set aside. Our job is to listen to Canadians. We don't always have to agree, even with what they're talking about. We don't agree with everything that they want to do.
But
obviously,
don't you lend credibility to people who are holding press conferences,
Evan,
that are trying to say we want to form a government that would not be democratically elected.
Evan, these people obviously did not understand. I don't think any sedition charges were laid, were they? They were not.
But it doesn't have to be. But there are lots of charges laid against some of the.
But I think this is the misinformation that's being spread. The people who protested here in Ottawa were, as you know, hundreds and thousands of them. They were upset. They wanted to be heard. And we as Conservatives believe that they deserve to be heard.
So what she's done there is taken a very strong position, one that we wish Aaron O'Toole had done in January, to say that, yes, Conservative members of Parliament and all members of Parliament should be listening to the people they represent. Absolutely, it was right for them to meet with James Topp, and they can do whatever they want as far as attending these events and not attending the events, whatever. Harrison, I mean, first off, before we get to the media reaction, where was this Conservative leadership in the last election?
I know. I mean, it just felt in the last election, Andrew, that every time there was an opportunity for a Conservative leader, for a Conservative politician to stand up and defend Canadians who are rightfully upset, who have real grievances with the government, they would just fold. And then, of course, as you said, at the beginning of the convoy protest, Aaron O'Toole was completely unwilling to stand up for Canadians, who many of them were looking for a leader. Many of them were probably not partisan, were not necessarily political, not wedded to one party or another. But yet, the conservatives didn't seem to seize that opportunity to take the chance to grab new support by just saying, you know what, we actually stand with you. We respect the issue that you, that we respect your concerns and understand your frustrations. And finally, it feels as though with Candace Bergen being the leader, that there has been this sort of, you know, this sort of kick into high gear from the conservatives to say, no, we're done kind of tiptoeing around this. We're going to firmly stand on the side of freedom. We're going to firmly stand on the side of Canadians who just have some legitimate concerns. And I mean, we're at a point now, Andrew, where it's refreshing to hear a conservative leader, a Canadian politician, say that Canadians have a right to protest the government. How have we gone to this point? It's just incredible.
Yeah, it is. And I mean, I will say I've always had a lot of appreciation for Evan Solomon. I don't agree with everything he says all the time, nor would I with anyone else. But I think he's very fair. And I think that, you know, he's playing devil's advocate in this context. But a lot of the people that are watching that really agree with what he's saying fundamentally in his line of questioning there, that the convoy was about people who were seeking to overthrow the government. And I will say, Candace Bergen had the great response to that. She said, well, there were no sedition charges, which is a bit glib, but I think it's raising an important point here, which is that all of these people want to say that this was a coup and this was treason. Well, I mean, no police have said that. The government's not even said that. We're not actually seeing that here. It was people who might be expressing a position the government wasn't all that fond of. And at the federal level, certainly the government wasn't fond of the message of freedom and opposition to vaccine mandates. But to say that there is something that a conservative leader needs to be held to account for that never happened, which is this mass attempt at an insurrection, is very disingenuous. But a lot of people still report it as though that's fact.
Well, they do. And you were in the press conferences with the organizers during the convoy, and I was there too. And they said explicitly, they said multiple times, Tamara Leach said it, BJ Dichter said it, Keith Wilson said it. They were not there to overthrow the government. They were not there to do what the media is saying. And you just said it too. Even the government doesn't run with this narrative. The police don't run with this narrative. The only people peddling this sedition narrative, this overthrowing the government narrative, are journalists, the legacy media journalists who are kind of holding on to that. Just that's their last thing they're holding on to try and continue their narrative. And it's slipping away because the facts are coming out. And the problem is, the organizers never really stood a chance when the legacy media was always stacked against them. They could have said they could have repeated themselves 100 times, Andrew. They could have said 100 times, they're not here to overthrow the government. And that would not have changed anything, in my opinion. They would have rolled with this narrative regardless. So there was really nothing that could be done. And in that interview with Evan Solomon, Candace Bergen not in the interview, but in a CTV article, Candace Bergen then had to basically say and defend conservative politicians going to a Canada Day event in Ottawa. We're now at the point where not only does a conservative leader have to be accountable for something that didn't happen, a conservative leader then has to defend the right of their caucus members, MPs, attending Canada Day celebrations in Ottawa. This is just insane.
Yeah, because what they're doing here basically is saying that when a group of people who love freedom and wave Canadian flags and are opposed to vaccine mandates get together to celebrate Canada Day, that is an inherently bad place. It's a bad thing to do. It's, you know, filled with deplorables and bad people. And again, we're going to see, I suspect, by the end of this weekend, the bouncy castles, the pig roast, the sauna, maybe not the saunas because it's July now, but you're going to see that same party-like atmosphere we saw in January and February, which MPs were attending, especially once Aaron O'Toole was deposed, and then you all of a sudden had MPs with free rein to go out and talk to people and all that jazz. But the one thing that was fascinating about seeing that this comment is that, again, people are treating this as news. Like, this strikes me as the epitome of a non-newsworthy thing. MPs encouraged to meet with constituents on Canada Day and hear their concerns. That strikes me as what should just be another day. But again, when you look at the media narrative of this, this is some radical concept.
Yeah, and they of course put quotes. They put you know the quotes around
so-called freedom protest.
I know it's it's so disingenuous. It's so ridiculous. They've made freedom this swear word, this word you can't say. And they have to, journalists feel they have to qualify the word freedom with quotes around it. It's incredible. And of course, as you said, how is this news when the leader says she supports the right for MPs to be at Canada Day protests? It's incredible. And I really hope we get to a point, Andrew, where the word freedom is no longer this big, scary word, where you're actually allowed to say, yeah, you know what? I support one of the core tenets of Canada. What it represents on the world stage is a free country.
Yeah, it's up there with the Canadian flag now. Like these thing, these symbols that the left claims the right has appropriated and ruined forever. Whereas, like, you know, if the right is the only group that's allowed to wave the Canadian flag and talk about freedom, I'm okay with that. But I think they're relinquishing these things because they didn't like them all that much in the first place. What else do we have going on this week?
So, well, we've got, of course, and it was just a matter of time when they dropped the vaccine, or they suspended, I should say, when the government suspended the travel mandate, the vaccine mandate, and they said many times, we'll bring it back if we have to. We knew the clock started ticking at that point until the media started to bring back the COVID fear-mongering, Andrew. Tell us that COVID is coming. It's just around the corner. We have to prepare for a summer surge, as the media said. The Globe and Mail just basically recycling headlines from the beginning of 2020. Here, the Globe and Mail wrote on June 29th, fears of a COVID-19 summer surge prompt experts to call for a return to masking. So here it is. The masks are going to come back, the fear is going to come back, and we're going to have to likely, if this continues, well, the restrictions are going to come back too. And it was just, as I said, a matter of time. So the article writes, it's time to bring back indoor mask wearing requirements, says some health professionals, amid concerns of a potential surge in COVID-19 cases this summer. So all I say to these health officials, Andrew, is good luck with that. Good luck convincing Canadians to bring back masks indoors. I don't think it's going to happen.
No, this is the number one way to get another convoy to Ottawa, to just exactly. Reimpose a wave of restrictions. And it's not going to be like the Bounty Castle one this time. I think they're going to hold out longer than 3 weeks.
And they're going to do it in the summer, too.
Yeah, exactly, when they don't have the weather working against them. I saw this, and my first response, and I tweeted about this, is that the experts, nothing is stopping them from wearing their masks as long as they want. They can double mask, triple mask. They can do an N95 with some duct tape. They can wear a full body suit, do whatever they want. That is absolutely their choice. It's the idea of imposing this, reimposing some national or at the very least province-wide mask mandate that I find so absurd here. And I was looking at this, and just one example from this week, and I know there are others like this. Western University in my neck of the woods, London, Ontario, they announced on, I think it was Wednesday, that they're going mask-free as of this week. But their vaccine mandate, they say, well, we're not going to tell you what we're going to do about that in September 1st. So if you're a student at Western or a faculty member at Western, you can't actually plan the next year because you won't know until days before the school year starts what the vaccine policy is. And the reason I bring that up in the context of this story is because it's that sort of Damocles that's always dangling in front of people now, that we're always just one day away from some new wave of restrictions coming back, one wave away from more concerns, more lockdowns, more restrictions, more vaccine mandates. And this could just come and hit us at any point. And this is something that I feel, I mean, for the first, 97 waves of restrictions and lockdowns and all that, Canadians did seem to welcome this all. But I'm not convinced that patience is there, because I know it's anecdotal, but people that dutifully went along with every lockdown, they got double vax, triple vax, they did everything. They hit a breaking point not long before this summer. And in some cases, a little bit earlier, but I just don't think the will is there, even among people that have followed every restriction up until this point, to deal with any more of them.
No, and the cat's out of the bag. I mean, what you're seeing now are you're seeing Canadians traveling to Europe where no mask, basically no one is wearing any masks. There were no restrictions months ago, and they weren't getting COVID. They weren't getting infected. They were coming back to places where there were masks. People were wearing masks, and there were some restrictions, and they were ending up with COVID. So people are starting to realize that you know, it's not the masks that are protecting them. And now with everyone getting, you know, boosted and still getting wave after wave of COVID, I mean, people, like you said, are just gonna realize that this is not working. This is not going to happen. And if they try this, people are just going to openly, you know, disagree with this. They're not going to follow along, and they're going to kind of lose the respect for the public health bureaucrats, the institutions of these people telling us what to do. And just to get into some of these absurd headlines we saw at the beginning of the week, the fearmongering has come right back. CTV wrote at the beginning of the week, and I can't even believe this was a headline written by CTV. They wrote, people with COVID-19 can infect and sicken cats and dogs by cuddling them. And they referenced a study. They say that the research that they referenced, published this month in the Journal of Emerging Infectious Diseases, involved 69 cats and 49 dogs, including pets and animals from shelters and neuter clinics. Transmission from humans to animals can be minimized by owners keeping their distance, wearing a mask, and taking other precautions, Andrew. So people in Canada are supposed to distance themselves from their own pets and wear masks around their own pets? Do they really take us for total idiots? It's crazy.
No, see, you're being insensitive, Harrison. This is the whole point, is that they know that even the most cynical, myopic, misanthropic people love animals. So now, if you're not prepared to wear your mask to save grandma, you have to wear your mask to save Fido. This is the rule now. How dare you?
Unbelievable. It's really, really just absurd stuff. And I do think they take us, a good chunk of us, for total chumps. And we've seen data like this come out, and it doesn't seem to affect or determine any of the rules we're forced with. We saw a study that said, completely ignored mental health and economic implications of Canada's lockdowns. And it said that Canada's COVID-19 response was better than many comparable countries. And this was, of course, published in the CBC, but they don't mention the fact that the study they were referencing of Canada's COVID lockdowns doesn't talk about the dangers and harms of the lockdowns on mental health and on the economy of our country. And all you have to do is look at True North's own reporting. In July of 2021, we wrote a story that said lockdowns killed more Canadians under 65 than COVID. And the majority of COVID victims were very old and had serious health problems, detailing exactly how the lockdowns and restrictions had severe damage on Canadians, and how the lockdown measures, although they might have minimized COVID numbers, they weren't overall positive. And that's not going to be reported on. And anytime it does get reported on, they're going to hide it around studies that don't even touch on those important facets, the reality of the situation, where our lockdowns and our restrictions had severe problems in our society. It doesn't seem to, one, it doesn't seem to register with the people who make the rules. And two, it doesn't seem like journalists even care or want to talk about these things.
No, and I think this was the big media malfeasance we saw. And to be fair, I think some of it was not that journalists were getting it wrong. I think some of it was that they were being fed bad information. And we were just told to trust the so-called experts and trust the doctors and all of that. And people didn't have the scientific knowledge to challenge it. And that is that we had this one-track focus on case counts. And the term that people used early on, which I think is a valid one, is a case-demic. When you have a pandemic and you're defining it solely in terms of what the cases are without looking at things like the severity of those cases, hospitalizations, and then you devote all your policy to getting to COVID zero, to getting cases down to zero, and as a result, you're locking people down. You're ruining child development. We could look at mental health numbers, addictions, domestic violence, all of that, and I think that's important, but it will take years, maybe even decades, really, or a decade, to see the collateral damage that's been caused by lockdowns. When you look at child development, when you look at social integration and socialization and all of these other things, and you're right, when they do this study and they don't even look at, oh, people who have lost their jobs, but it's okay, yeah, they had the sniffles for a couple of weeks, and we prevented more people from getting the sniffles in some cases, but those people lost their small business, they lost their restaurant. That doesn't strike me as a victory for a lockdown.
No, it's not, and but you know what? It's this sort of reporting and it's these sorts of studies that are intentionally leaving out important facets of the pandemic, key underreported realities of the pandemic that will be relied on when, as we're already seeing, the fear-mongering ramps up and there is another excuse for governments to impose these restrictions. I wouldn't be surprised to see research like this be the justification to say, if COVID cases come up again, that say, well, we need to not learn from the reality of the situation where our lockdowns, our rules, and our restrictions caused major societal problems. No, we need to go back to minimizing cases, looking only at how many people have the flu, a mild flu, and just basically turn a total blind eye to all of the issues we know now from these brutal restrictions. And Andrew, yeah, switching gears on the show, we came across this funny article in the Toronto Star from Althea Raj, and this is sort of in line with the perception of conservatives being negative and nasty, and it's sort of a carryover from the Freedom Convoy coverage of the people who are just wanting freedom, who are lovely people, who are people that, you know, would be your neighbors in your communities. They're actually these sort of nasty and rude people. And so we saw this article from Althea Raj, which basically talks about her frustration with the anger and the nasty comments from the conservatives in the House of Commons. And the title of this story is, it starts off with, "Bend over, you're despicable. Name-calling and disrespect are now all too common in the House of Commons." And so she starts off by saying, from my perch above the speaker's chair this week, I witnessed a shocking level of name-calling and disrespect. You're despicable and bend over were some of the insults hurled from the conservative side toward the liberal benches. So of course, what a surprise, Andrew. This article is criticizing conservatives, the opposition in government, for getting a little too rowdy in the House of Commons. I've sat in question period in Queen's Park, and I watch enough question period here at True North to know that name calling, like, you know, some good jabs and some good back and forth, some good banter is what you do in the House of Commons. That's what it's always been, and that's how it is in every Westminster system.
Yeah, and I think the one thing that I found interesting here, and she mentioned it, I think, in the very first paragraph, is that every June, this is the gripe. Journalists and politicians complain about the toxicity in the House of Commons every June. So if it's happening every year, then it stands to reason that this is something that no one's had any interest in doing anything about. And that spans from government to government, from opposition to opposition, as these things change over time. And again, I'm not going to say politics is not a place that invites incivility. I don't know if the conduct from MPs is getting worse. I think certainly political discourse on social media has gotten worse. But at the end of the day, if this is a recurring thing, the people that are supposed to do something about it are the people that are in politics. And you have the Speaker of the House, who right now is a Liberal, who has the ability to throw out anyone who's used unparliamentary language. So I think that a lot of the times people will take little excerpts and little words that, yeah, someone probably shouldn't have said or might not have been the most acceptable. And we could say perhaps they should have expressed themselves a different way. But you also are talking about a group of people that are thrown into a room, 338 of them, that is by design adversarial. Well, they talk about things that affect people's lives. So if there wasn't passion in that room, I'd be very concerned.
Exactly. And this is what has been the case forever. You can go back and read transcripts from question periods since the very beginning of our country.
Oh, some of the old school ones are great. Like, he's lily livered codswallop hoggler. I made that up, but it's something like that.
If we could decipher it into modern English, I'm sure that they would really, really get under the skin of liberal journalists like Althea Raj. But I mean, we have countless examples of our prime minister using rather unparliamentary language in the House of Commons. And in 2011, this is what Justin Trudeau said to Conservative Minister of the Environment, Peter Kent. Just watch this.
Well, Mr. Speaker, my honorable colleague, if she had been in Durban, would have seen that, in fact, Canada was among the leaders in creating the...
Order. 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 Order.
So there you go, Andrew. That's not what I would consider to be parliamentary language. I wonder what Althea Raj would have said about that if she was sitting above or sitting in her perch above the speaker's chair, as she said.
I'll give Althea credit. I don't think Althea is the problem here. I think the problem that we have is outsiders looking into this. And I'm not like outsiders in the sense of people that aren't sitting in the chambers thinking it's bad, but what do you propose is the solution? And I think that's the issue here, is that do we want to just police language more in there? Do we want to start taking them out to the woodshed and, you know, giving them a couple of penalties anytime someone heckles impolitely or something like that? And I guess that's the issue, is like, it seems to be a problem that everyone kind of calls out as a problem, but I don't see a solution that doesn't just make things a heck of a lot worse. And I think anytime someone goes to the can't we all get along, why aren't we nicer thing, their natural instinct is to find that the other side is meaner than their side, when I suspect you'll find a lot of evidence this is going in every which direction.
Oh yeah, no, absolutely. And no, maybe it's not just Althea Raj putting this forward, but again, it's the idea that the comment needs to be made about conservatives in the House of Commons, you know, having, you know, unparliamentary language and unsavory language, as you said. It's been that way forever. It goes both ways. It's designed to be that way. And everybody knows that MPs are passionate. And like you said, if you're not passionate about the issues, especially in a time like right now that we're living through, in which our government is taking massive liberty upon themselves to shrink the liberty of Canadians, that is a time in which I would expect most conservative MPs or most opposition MPs, regardless of political stripe, to get fired up, to have, you know, to let them hear it, to let the government hear it, because that is kind of what the whole system is set up to do.
Yeah, very much so. And we always try to end things on a bit of a lighter note. So we're going to call you all racists if you have front lawns. That's our version of a lighter note here on Fake News Friday, because also the Toronto Star, interestingly enough, they're on the greatest hits list this week, has a column, "Lawns are an outdated cultural norm. Let's lose them before we lose the pollinators." And they say that being a lawn owner used to be a symbol of being rich, rich enough to hold land and not need to farm on it. But this is just an outdated cultural norm. It's classist. It's supposed to differentiate the aristocrats from the farmers. And now it's just a sign of societal excess. But this is actually part of a longstanding grievance that people have, that we can go back to a Globe and Mail piece a couple of years ago about the need to decolonize the lawn. We need to decolonize the lawn because a lawn is you saying that you're vanquishing nature, which is a part, according to one history professor, of settler culture. So if you have a lawn, you are disenfranchising Indigenous people and you are a classist aristocrat. I think I've gotten it right.
I think you do. And I'm reading this quote from the Globe and Mail piece from 2020, and it's at the back end of a longer quote from a Canadian history professor. And he says, when he's talking about backyards this time, not front lawns, he says, "A backyard with a big lawn is like a classroom for colonialism and environmental hostility." So I guess they're really upset about nice lawns. And this funny thing is from the Toronto Star, when they talk about the time, you know, the lawn is an outdated cultural norm, we should just, I guess, bulldoze the lawns and pave them over. And they say, of course, that the reason the lawn is a problem is because of biodiversity and climate crises. So those competing biodiversity and climate crises, what better way, Andrew, to solve those climate crises than to just pave over your lawns?
We got to do the Joni Mitchell song, pave paradise and put up a parking lot. So everyone needs a concrete front yard. Now, in fairness, there are people that have turned their lawns, I forget the term, I think it's like living lawns or something, or they do like front lawn gardens. And if you're going to tend to them, that's very nice. But I assure you, if I were to turn my front lawn into a garden of some kind, because I can barely grow grass. So I'm not colonizing anyone, because I can't, you know, grow anything but weeds there. Not weed, weeds. This is the thing that I find hilarious, that we all need to just like let the bees take over, apparently. And that, I mean, this Planet of the Apes is going to be Planet of the Bees, because that's the only way to outdate the outdated norm, make it outdated, whatever the case is, who knows.
Well, yeah, and if you did that, Andrew, you'd be following the Toronto Star's guideline, you'd be following their manual. In it, they say to maintain natural debris, including dead stems and dry leaves. What may seem messy to some people is habitat to wildlife. So, you know, if you have a lawn, just let it go, let it kind of be an awful mess. Let weeds grow in it and leave a bunch of I don't know, you know, dead branches and dead stems in it. I mean,
this is great, Harrison. When my wife asks me to rake the leaves in the fall, I'll just say, I'm decolonizing. I can't rake the leaves. They've got to stay.
They've got to stay there. And I'm just listening to the Toronto Star.
Yeah. Well, I won't use that because I don't think that's authoritative. But I'll appeal to our greater goals as a society to move beyond colonization. Last year, the issue was we couldn't fly the Canadian flag. This year, you can't grow your grass. So do whatever works for you there. I hope you are all having an absolutely wonderful Dominion Day, wherever you're celebrating, whether you're in Ottawa or at home. Thanks very much for indulging. Harrison Faulkner on the other end of the virtual microphone, host of the show Ratioed. And I'm Andrew Lawton. Harrison, have a good Dominion Day.
And to you, Andrew.
All right, to the rest of you, we'll talk to you next week with more Fake News Friday. Thank you, God bless, and have a good weekend.